Hello, Mike. How are you?
I'm good, mate. Long time no speak to.
It's been a long time. I spoke at your conference in 2006.
I know, I know. My goodness, 2006. 13
So much time has
almost,
passed.
yeah, 12 and a half years now. My
You
goodness.
know, I'm on your social media. I'm looking at all your list of different pages. Social media management services, life will never be the same again, magic moments, Google domination, first page ranking, Dreamweaver, former gratitude rocks. It just goes on and on. So you've got a lot of energy, Mike. Is that fair to say?
But you know, about 30 years ago, actually more than 30 years ago, my manager at the time called me Dynamic Mike, and I just, you know, I've just used it as a label ever since, and I thought, as a label goes, that's a pretty good one. I'm
Yeah.
quite happy with
I like
it.
it. Yeah. So how's life for you now, Mike? I mean, you appear to be quite an entrepreneur, but also an adventure thrill seeker as well. I mean, I can see that you love traveling, you love having experiences. So what's your lifestyle at the moment?
Well, do you know, it's fascinating actually. I reflect on that. In 2006, when I met you, I was a financial advisor. I was running my own business, and doing very well actually. And in fact, I was doing so well that I decided one of my colleagues, if you like, one of my friends, I should say, he was also doing some motivational speaking, some inspirational speaking, and so was I. I was doing a bit of the speaking circuit at the time. And he it was his suggestion, and he said, wouldn't it be amazing to inspire like 10,000 people at once? And instead of patting on the shoulder and saying, good idea, off you go, I went, let's do it. Threw my arms up in the air and said, yeah, let's do it. Next thing I knew, it became my baby and my project, and he disappeared off the radar, in fact, for a few months. And it took me 18 months to put it all together. But I hired the only conference centre in Scotland at the time that could host 10,000 people, which was the SECC, the Scottish Exhibition Conference Centre in Glasgow. And they said to me, "Are you sure you want the 10,000 seater? Because you know, even Kylie just takes the 3,000 seater." And I went, yeah, let's do it, you know, build it and they will come. I've got to have that goal, you know. So anyway, I did, and even just the hall itself for the 3-day rental was quarter of a million.
What?
Yep, exactly, for 3 days.
A quarter of a million.
And my youngest son said, "Are you buying it, Dad?" And I just laughed and said, "It feels like
Oh,
it, but no,
Jesus.
I've got it for 3 days
Fucking
only."
hell.
So yeah, exactly. So are you recording this, by
Oh, yeah, we're rolling.
the way? Anyway, I rented it, and I, as I said, I put 18 months into it. It became a 24-hour a day job, if you like, and I put everything else on hold. And I closed, effectively closed down my IFA business. And I just told all my clients, you know, I'm going to be reactive rather than proactive. So if you want me, then you know where I am. Here's all my contact details. And that was really fascinating as well, because in hindsight, I had about, I think about four clients call me in that 12-month period immediately after telling them that. And I made, I wouldn't say just from four clients, but I made around about 20 grand from my financial advisory business in that year, and it cost me about 20 grand to be a financial advisor in that year. So that was quite fascinating actually, and the lesson there, I guess, is you can't afford to be reactive, you know, even though you've built up a good business. And a lot of people like to, you know, use the term passive income, and one of my realizations is passive income is a misnomer. It's a nonsense. Change it to recurring income, and you're onto something. But even if you've got property or whatever, you know, even a bookseller or an author, etc., you know, all those, it will disappear off the radar. Mostly, some won't, but the majority will just disappear if you do nothing about it. And you've got to maintain it. So anyway, on that particular story, that particular project cost me 700 grand to put it on, and it all came out of my own pocket.
Whoa.
I fortunately I had the money to make it happen, but I don't now. It
So
disappeared. Anyway,
how was the event? What happened?
well, I made it happen. That was the most important thing. I was so determined to make it happen. And at one stage, we got a call from Sir Bob Geldof saying, "I've heard about this event and I want to be part of it." That
Wow.
was like, and
Hey,
I was like, "No, I wanted Richard Branson, not Bob Geldof."
So hold on, let's just go through some of the details with this. So I actually wasn't aware of the event. Well, my friend James told me about it, and I vaguely remember seeing it, but because it was in Scotland, and it just, you know, it wasn't really on my radar really, but I was vaguely aware of it. So like, who was speaking? You know, tell us more.
Well, it was interesting because it was a number of people that were quite well known in the personal development world, but in Scotland, especially at that time, there wasn't a big personal development world at all, awareness. And so people that you will know as because you're in that world is people like Peter Sage and Richard Wilkins. I actually ran a second Inspire Scotland event in the October, which is when you were speaking as well. You spoke at my internet summit that I hosted. I hosted the first internet summit in Scotland as well. And basically, I decided that I had put so much money and time into making this first event happen, and it was a financial disaster for me.
Did it make a loss?
It made a, it, I lost virtually everything. I lost everything,
Oh,
seriously.
Jesus.
Oh, and actually, that's one of the phrases we use, isn't it? I lost my money. I didn't just lose my money. I lost, my attitude changed as well as a result. So I lost my girlfriend. I ended up with 40 grand in debt. I didn't lose my girlfriend. I pushed her away. Because I didn't feel good enough anymore, and I can only say that in hindsight because I didn't realize at the time what was going on. But
Hey, so how long did it take you to get over that emotionally? I mean, it sounds like it had an impact on your state of mind and stuff.
still has an emotional effect on me, to be honest. But I mean, at the time, I ended up with 40 grand in debt from living the millionaire lifestyle. I ended up having borrowed 30 grand from my mum and 10 grand from my girlfriend's mum. So I chose to sell my house and sell my car to pay them back. So at least I could hold my head high with dignity
Yeah.
and integrity.
Hey, what year was this, Mike?
That was literally, I hosted the events in 2006. So 2007, I sold up everything
Right.
my feet financially. And I'd gone from, living a great lifestyle with in the nice car and the nice house and all the rest of it, to suddenly being massively in debt. Not massive, to my mind, 40 grand was a massive debt.
Yeah,
It's
compared
all
to having a large net
well,
worth, yeah, it's a big
I
difference, isn't
couldn't
it?
see a way out of it. But let's put it that. In fact, seriously, I was honestly on the verge of committing suicide because I couldn't see a way out.
You really were.
Yeah, seriously, and I honestly just myself. Talk at the time was people will understand, because I genuinely couldn't see a way out, and so that's really fascinating. So I went from living a great lifestyle to having absolutely sweet FA left.
So prior to that point, you'd accumulated quite a large net worth. And how had you done that, from being a financial advisor or from other businesses
No,
as
I
well?
was financially. I was actually one of the very few financial advisors who were taking their own advice. I was actually the chairman of the financial advisory professional body in the year 2000, and I knew most of the key players, if you like, most of the key people in Scotland, and I knew that I was in the top tier. I was in the top maybe 1 or 2%.
So you were self-made.
Yeah, totally, totally.
And how long
But
had
I
it
had
taken to
a great
accumulate
system.
that?
To be fair, it was just a great system I had. I employed 10 staff, and yet I was the
Jesus.
only one bringing the money in. And yeah, I just had a system. They were all, they all had an easy job, if you like, because the systems were there.
Oh, I
And so
see.
they
Your marketing and sales system was effective, and then you had staff that were kind of managing the relationships. Is that?
Well, yeah, because at the end of the day, financial advice is actually really, really strictly governed. And so I just had people to dot the I's and cross the T's and make sure my backside was covered, so that, whatever I was saying was, I could back it all up. That's actually what financial advice has become. It's really not a nice environment to be. I mean, I guess everything is, the police and the NHS and everything. It's so
Yeah.
much paper now.
It's just compliance, basically.
Compliance became, well, it is. It's a nightmare. It's a horrible situation to be in. I'm employing people literally just to make sure that I'm compliant.
Right.
But
So,
anyway, you're
wow,
done.
this is I wasn't aware of all this, Mike. So it's really interesting to hear you tell the story. I don't know what to ask. There's so many things I want to ask. So
How long have you got?
2007. So you do the event. By the way, I'm sorry that it once. I'm sorry to hear that.
Well, actually, let me just say, there's something that I mentioned there, and I thought I want to finish that. One of the phrases you used, and I did as well, because it's a common phrase that we use, is "I lost my money," and it took me 3 years, literally, of saying that before it occurred to me that actually I didn't lose my money. I had deliberately encashed my savings. I knew exactly what I was doing and when I was encashing them, to make it happen, to make that event happen. And I'm bloody made it happen. I was so determined to make that event happen, even though it was costing so much. And even just 6 weeks before the event happened, the first event, I had to pay the extra. I had to pay the last 55 grand, balance due on the hall rental, and I was like, I've only sold a handful of tickets, and I'm only 6 weeks away. But I decided, if this is when everybody's going to turn to me and say, "Oh, I was going to come," and I would have been perfectly in my right to go, "Yeah, but you didn't buy a bloody ticket in time, did
Were there unexpected costs that you never imagined would come up for an event like that?
No, I was
Did
a
it go
bit
over
silly.
budget?
I was just, yeah. I mean, in hindsight, there were so many things that I would have done more cleverly if I hadn't had the money, if I hadn't had the resources. For example, I had zero sponsors. And if I had no money, I would have been much more creative in working out ways to cover the costs. But because I had the financial resources, I just paid for it all out of my own pocket and made it happen.
I see.
I ended up in a silly situation going from, as you said, self-made to get to that point, and then all of a sudden going, bloody hell, I literally couldn't even meet people for a cup of coffee because I knew that I couldn't afford to buy them one back. And
God, I didn't
so
realize this, Mike. I didn't know this happened to you.
it's devastating, confidence-wise as well. It really put me into such a downward spiral that I went and hid in my cave, to be honest. And I was just like, I didn't want to face anybody. I want to, speak to anybody. And it's just like, if people knew this, it certainly wouldn't be very inspiring, would it?
Well, I'm curious, like, what's the was the primary emotion embarrassment, or what was it? What was the underlying deep sort of unpleasant feeling?
Totally. Embarrassment at having put myself in such a stupid situation, and the loss of confidence from having, I didn't realize how much money, having a cash flow, a comfortable cash flow situation, made a difference to your confidence. I really appreciated that. And then all of a sudden, I was just like, do you know what? I've got nothing left to lose now. So actually, that's when I decided to take off in my camper van around Europe.
I remember that.
I had no finances. I had nothing financially left to keep me here in the UK. I'm currently in the UK, because I was just like, I've spoken on the internet marketing platform around the world. Now's the time to walk the talk. Stop talking about it. And it seemed to me that I was disillusioned at that stage as well, because most of the speakers were actually making their money by selling from the back of the room rather than actually walking the talk, in my opinion. And although I couldn't prove that, I wanted to be, I knew myself, I want to walk the talk and see if I can actually generate my income via the laptop as I travel.
So,
So,
there's so much I want to ask, and I do want to get to the like the more positive stuff of, what happened after that. But I'm just curious, was that the lowest point in your life?
That was the start of the lowest point.
Oh.
A number of low points thereafter,
Oh, okay.
and it was all money and confidence related. For example, one that sticks in my mind just now was it was Valentine's Day. I was on my camper van tour. I was in Sicily, and I'd 2 days before, I think I'd got down to my last 20 euro, and at that time, still, my money comes in via the internet. All my money comes in via the internet. So most of that is PayPal. And PayPal at that time was taking about 9 to 11 days to actually transfer through to the bank. So even if I made money today, it would take another 9 days before I could take out the ATM. And it was about 2 days before Valentine's. I was down to my last 20 euro. And I thought, what do I do here? It's February. It wasn't freezing cold in Sicily. I think it got down to about 4 degrees at night, but my only heating was running the camper van engine, and putting the blasters on inside the camper van. So, I'm like, do I buy fuel to keep us warm, basically, or do I buy food for me and the dog? With my 20 euro. And so what I ended up doing was spending 15 quid on both. I managed to split it. I got some food and some fuel, and I kept a five just to make me feel I haven't totally gone to zero. Anyway, on Valentine's Day, it happened to, it was a Saturday, and I remember walking and just contemplating, reflecting basically, because in the past I've taken girlfriends to New York and to Ibiza and Paris and all sorts just for Valentine's Day, just because I could, and all of a sudden I'm like, I've got nobody in my life and I've got zero income, and I took myself for a walk, and we were literally standing at the top of a cliff, looking down on the waves crashing in the rocks below, and I remember saying to the dog, shall we do it? And I was going to take my dog with me because in Sicily, they really don't treat dogs well at all. Dogs are wild running around the streets, and they treat them like vermin. They don't like dogs. So I didn't want to leave him as an orphan in that country. So I was going to take him with me. And then I started thinking, I don't want to be a murderer to my dog. And then I was looking down at the rocks thinking, that water looks bloody freezing. What if I don't die? What if I just break a leg and get hypothermia? If
Oh
I'm
man.
going
So,
to come, I
but
want to make sure it happens, and that's the end of it. So,
what date was that? What year was that, rather?
it was Valentine's Day. That was 2009,
Oh man.
2009. And so anyway, I was reflecting and I thought, wait a minute, I think I've hidden some money from myself. From myself. How funny is that? In my camper van, before I actually left the UK, I stored money in different places, like in shoes and so on and so forth, different places in the camper van. And so I started thinking about where had I hidden some money? So I went back from the cliffs, I went back to the camper van and had a look. And sure enough, I found £250 sterling.
Nice.
In different places, in hidden in the van, and this was a Saturday, and of course the banks don't open till the Monday, but that's okay. I've got resources. I've got food in the cupboard, so I'm fine. So on the Monday, I went to the biggest town in Sicily, which is Palermo, the capital, and so I parked the van and I went looking around all the banks and even, pardon me, even the post office to see what the exchange rate was and so on. And then I went back to the place that was going to give me the best exchange rate, and they were bloody closed. They have like a siesta type thing for hours. Another 3 hours or so I've got to waste, Walking around town, so that's okay. It was a nice day. And
Well, when you're down to your last few quid, a £250 is a lot of money in that moment, isn't it?
yeah, but I needed to exchange it to euros.
Yeah.
So anyway, I went back, and they this is quite funny. They were arguing with me because the how they had it in the bank. They had a it turned out that some of my money was in Scottish notes and some was English notes. And in fact, £150 was in Scottish notes, and they had a picture of, by coincidence, it was Royal Bank of Scotland, and that's what they had in the little A4 brochure. They had a postage stamp size image of notes from all around the world, and it was actually the Royal Bank of Scotland that they had, and I thought that's quite lucky because there are actually, there's Clydesdale Bank and there's Bank of Scotland, and so they print their own money as well. And they didn't have those banks, but they did have the Royal Bank, so that was lucky. But my note was 2004, and the note that she had in her brochure was 1999, and the image was different. And she was arguing, saying, no, my note wasn't legal tender. And I was like, well, wait a minute, my note is actually more up to date than your picture. And so she refused to exchange my money. So, of course, I started getting ratty about it. And one of the words I'd picked up was chef, which I think means chief or manager. So I was like, I want to speak to your chef. So anyway, this stroppy woman come out, this Italian woman taking no shit. She was like, she looked at the brochure and she looked at my money and she was like, no, we exchange your English money, which was £100, but not your Scottish money. And if you don't like it, we exchange nothing. And I was like, oh, okay. So in that case, I'll take the English money, £100 worth, and I'll go to another bank for the Scottish. So that's what I ended up doing. And by the time I got back to the camper van, I'd been there for 6 hours, and it just so happened that the parking in that place was 1 euro per hour. And I was laughing because I was like, this morning I only had 5 euros. And actually, as it happens, because I was in a camper van, they wanted 1 euro 50 per hour, so I had to pay 9 euros to get out. But I'm laughing to myself, thinking, if I hadn't managed to exchange my money, what would you do? What could you do? I literally genuinely only have 5 euros. I couldn't even pay for the parking. But anyway, that was enough. That was enough to give me breathing space. I mean, it's not enough to get off the island, but I could breathe for, a few weeks and concentrate and bring in money in again. So the great thing about the camper van, of course, is that you don't need to go anywhere. You can just stay and concentrate on the internet when you need to, or go and take photos and enjoy the weather, etc., when you need to.
I'm curious about your state of mind. Who were you confiding in at that point in time?
Well, no whatsoever. That was the other thing. Of course, I was hundreds and hundreds of miles from my nearest friend. And so there was no point in confiding with anyone. And I certainly, the last ego was my biggest competitor, if you like, because the last thing I would have done is ask my family for money. So nobody has the answer to your question.
Right. I mean, I guess that must be really tough in terms of, are you the kind of person? I mean, personally, I find it much better if I can talk to people and relate to people in order to talk about problems and stuff. And I find, when I'm on my own and problems are just going round in my head and I'm not talking to anybody, they get worse and worse and worse, and everything feels worse and worse and worse. How was that for you?
Yeah, devastating. But I actually, funnily enough, as I said, I've spoken around the world on the internet marketing platform, and one of the things I often say that I think is different from any other speaker is, don't do what I've done. I think most speakers say, look at me, look how amazing I am. I'll sell you my course, which teaches you to do what I've done. And I actually say, no, actually, I don't believe that. I've been the person that stares at the screen all friggin' day. I've put the tens of thousands of hours into staring at a screen. And I'm telling you now, it's a very, very, very lonely world. And I actually feel sorry for the teenagers of today who only have that as an experience, they think their world revolves around social media, and if nobody likes me or likes this comment, then I'm doing something wrong. So I really feel sorry, I feel for them, and I often say that you know, don't do what I've done. Do what I would suggest we do is you hire an expert to do what they do best. A great example of this actually happened just yesterday. My mum actually she's got a big grandfather clock in the house, and it's got three weights that she has to pull the chain to put the weight back up the top. And I think one's for the minutes, one's for the hours, and one's for the chime, I think. But the chains had become stretched because of the weights, and one of the weights actually literally fell off because it stretched the chain so much. So she managed to get the pliers out, and she's managed to squeeze the links back and so on. And she said to me just yesterday, "Can you fix that clock?" And I was like, "Do you know, I've never even looked inside a clock before." So I said, "No, I'm really sorry, but I would suggest no. I might be able to fix it, but I would suggest no, I can't, because I've never even looked inside a grandfather clock. So I would definitely recommend you pay an expert to come in and sort it, you know." And it just so happens my dad's family were watchmakers and clockmakers, so of course I've got at least two uncles that can do that for us, so she can call them. But it did make me think, you know, that's the point of this message, is pay an expert to do what they do best so you can continue doing what you do best. And you know, and the internet world, I think, especially for solopreneurs, the great mistake that most solopreneurs make is that they think that they've got to do it all themselves. And as you know, because you're a part of that as well, there's a hell of a lot to learn. You know, if you want to start going, "Oh, I need a landing page now. Oh, I need an autoresponder now. Oh," you know, and it just never ends, you know. There's always something more to learn. I mean, personally, it gives me a buzz. I love, I buy software almost daily because I get so excited about where we're going next and what else we can do with it. But that's my buzz. I love helping businesses to get seen on the internet, because that's what gives me a buzz, you know. I often say to business owners, you know, you by all means know about it, but don't get sucked into thinking that you should be doing that yourself, because it really is a lonely world, and it's great if that's what you want to become the expert in. But if that's not your forte, then don't do it.
Let me tell you, like, some of my own story has run in parallel. Like, there's a lot of similar things I've gone through to yours. I think you've done it much bigger than me. I mean, it's interesting actually. When you invited me to come and speak at your conference in 2006, I had just launched my first website, the online guitar lesson thing, which I don't do anymore, by the way. And it was almost around about the exact same time. Like, literally that month, I just started making sales online, you know, kind of passive in quotes. Took a lot of work, but passive. I remember driving at, like, I didn't have any money, you know, and I could just about afford the fuel to, you know, to drive up to Scotland, you know, just, and I can't remember where I stayed. I stayed in a cheap travelodge or something like that. And, like, I don't know, I was making maybe like £5 a day or £10 a day in sales, and I was checking my PayPal like every 30 seconds to see if another sale had come in, you know. And I remember, and you know, that's a really exciting feeling. That was the first time, you know, that was my first experience with online sales. And I remember driving back, I think I slept in my car at the halfway home, and I remember checking my PayPal. And, like, there's another 20 quid, you know, there's somebody else has bought some guitar lessons, and, you know, it's a real buzz. And then fast forward, it became pretty successful over the next couple of years. And eventually, it's not a very interesting story, but eventually I got myself in a mess, couldn't pay my income tax bill, and ended up going bankrupt, you know, over a period of several years. And so, you know, I've had my own kind of ups and downs that, you know, not as extreme as your story, but still, I've had my own similar journey. And even things you were saying, like Valentine's Day, like, I remember, you know, after I'd done the guitar lesson thing, after it had been successful, after I'd been bankrupt, I had a girlfriend, and I remember I didn't have any money, and I was gonna get, I think it was New Year's Eve or Valentine's or something, where I was gonna go and see her, and I didn't have any money. And I remember I launched a product in the afternoon just to bring in, like, and you know, just to make any sales that I could, just to, and I did this online video tutorial of how to set up a WordPress website or something like that, something real basic. I sent it out to whatever list I had, and like I made one sale. It was like 20 quid, and it was just enough to buy a bottle of wine and some food, and you know, and like I went down her house, you know, like you know, I relate to a lot of what you're saying. You know, I've had some similar experiences, and
It can be quite devastating, really, to put all those hours into creating. You know, when I was traveling around Europe in the camper van, it was just when social media was coming out, and I had the time and the inclination to go, oh, what's this then? What's a Facebook fan page? Oh, what's a Twitter? You know, and I didn't just want to learn it; I wanted to dominate. You know, but I ended up writing advanced guides on all of the different social media channels and video tuition and all sorts on SEO, etc. And then, you know, trying to sell it and realizing, you know, I've put hours into this and I've got like one sale at $27. It's like, damn, nobody wants this. What's next? It's devastating, isn't it? But, you know, there's more lots of lessons in that, actually.
Did you actually end up going bankrupt or not?
No, I didn't. Fortunately, touch wood, I didn't. But I probably should have at the time. You know, I look at a few of my friends who have done it, and it certainly cleared their head for them as well, and allowed them to the freedom to get on with it. Actually, there's another interesting story. Another friend of mine, and it was just about the same time that I was going through my financial challenges. I think it was just, yeah, it was after the Inspire Scotland event. And he was also a fellow financial advisor. And I'd known him for about, I don't know, maybe a decade. And a few years earlier, I had paid for him to, well, I'd paid for a ticket to go to a stock market training weekend. And it was like, I don't know, 2,400 quid or something it was. But I got two tickets. So I said to him, "Do you want to come along as my guest?" And then a few months later, there was a property training weekend, and it was about the same price. And so he invited me as his guest. And that particular weekend, I was just sitting there, sort of yawning, thinking, "Ah, I know 97% of this. You know, it's quite." Bo-. And I remember him saying, "Mike, you know, I've paid a lot of money for this, so I'm going to make it work, you know." And I was like, oh, okay, fair enough. Anyway, within 18 months, he had purchased 300 properties.
What?
Exactly. But the but is, his model was such that he needed to purchase four properties a week, because he was employing a whole team of people to go in and fix the properties, and
Fucking hell.
his whole model was designed around remortgaging immediately.
So,
So,
was he doing work to them and increasing the value?
yeah. Well, sometimes some of them. The other properties that he was buying was basically people that needed to sort out their own finances, and so he was buying them, at, you know, 65% of the value. Which allowed people to pay off their mortgage and have 15 grand left or whatever it was. And then immediately he was remortgaging it up to 90%. So he was releasing, you know, the equity. And then he was spending that on A, on his lifestyle, but B, on the next property and so on, you know. So it's, his model was such that he needed to buy four properties a week. And then, of course, the whole credit crunch struck around about 2008, and the banks were no longer lending up to 100%, so they were lending like 75%, and his model kind of crashed. So he knew that he was going to go, he chose to go bankrupt, and he gave back 115 properties to the bank and kept a whole hoard of them as well. And I remember going to his house. He had a pretty decent sized house, and he had a big gym in one of the rooms, and we would do some workouts in there quite regularly. And he showed me, after we did the workout, he showed me that day he had just gone out and spent 40 grand. He had bought a 10,000 £1,000 Rolex, and he'd bought 10 grand's worth of surround sound system for his TV room, you know. And so, you know, the big projector and surround sound and all the rest of it. I didn't see that installed yet, but he'd gone out that day and he'd spent 40 grand, including a, you know, holiday to Thailand and all sorts. And he'd slapped it all on his credit card. Then he knew that, I think it was the next day or 2 days later, he was going to go to the bank to sign the papers to go bankrupt. And I was just, do you know what fascinated me? I had to use the word fascination, because otherwise I'd go into judgment mode. Because I was thinking, this is fascinating, because I was in the same situation where I found myself with 40 grand's worth of debt and I was going to take my life. And yet here's a guy that knows that he's going to go bankrupt and he's deliberately choosing to abuse the system and put another 40 grand on his credit card before he signs the papers. And he's doing it from a totally, in my point, in my view, a totally selfish way. But his attitude was, credit card companies don't give a toss, you're just a number. And I thought, wow, you know, if I'd had that attitude, I wouldn't have put myself through so much mental turmoil, because to me, it was all about integrity. I wanted to pay everything back and you know, keep my head above with integrity, you know, the dignity. But he didn't see anything wrong with what he did, and he did it, you know. And I remember driving home that night just thinking and just reflecting, thinking, you know, it'd be easy for me to be in judgment mode here, but I need to flip this and go, what's the lesson here for me? Why did I give myself such a hard time when so many other people don't?
You know? Yeah, it's very interesting, isn't it? How people have completely different psychologies. Obviously, you're very conscientious and, like you said, integrity is high importance to you. And I can relate to that too. I go to therapy, right? And we were chatting about this and we were talking it through and we figured out, like, I don't like anything unearned. Like, it's almost like I don't want anything that I haven't earned. The idea of being sort of given something or inheriting something or kind of being helped, like, it kind of, you know, I don't like that. And it irritates me if other people sort of have unearned stuff in a way. I don't know what the conclusion.
Well, do you know, one of my lessons from that, Ben, was the year after I did my Inspire Scotland event and I ended up in financial challenges. I didn't go bankrupt, but I found myself in a real shithole of in negative cash flow and right down to the wire where I genuinely couldn't meet someone for a coffee. And I remember my lesson for the whole year was that to accept gracefully and gratefully if someone wants to pay for a coffee for me. And I thought, you know, I've paid people's mortgages, you know, I've paid people's rent, I've taken people out for meals and all sorts like that. Never ever do you think that's a debt you owe me. You know, you're just like, that's life. If you've got it, you let it flow, you know, and that's actually one of the biggest lessons, is everything's got to flow. And cash is just like a wave. It will come and it will go. And it's got to. You start to hold on to it, that's wrong. By all means, accumulate like I had done to, you know, make the world a better place. But let it flow and help others when you can. And then the lesson I had to learn was to gratefully and gracefully accept and stop letting the ego beat you up.
Mike, where did you get this kind of pride and this integrity? It's almost like it's like you're living up to sort of very high sort of, what am I trying to say? Sort of, like, was your parents like this? Was your dad like the same?
Totally. Yeah, totally. You're right. You're spot on. My dad was a chartered accountant, and he's gone now. He's dead now, but he's left my mum in a nice financial situation, and you know, and integrity was probably his number one priority as well. So that was kind of not drummed into me, but it's kind of something that I was brought up with, I guess. So yeah, you're right, absolutely. I'm still trying to live up to my dead dad's desires, if you like.
Yeah. Because, like you said, like you gave the example of the other guy who had no shame. And obviously, he's got a different psychology to you or I. And, yeah. It is interesting, isn't it? How some of us, we feel like we need to, we got some inner standards and inner pride that we have to live up to. But at the same time, it's a double-edged sword, isn't it? Because if we find ourselves not living as we believe we should, that's extremely burdensome on us, isn't it? That kind of tortures us in a way, and so it's a double-edged sword.
Well, it's interesting. I mean, the phrase you used there was he had no shame, and I wouldn't say that about him. Interestingly enough, he's actually one of them. He's almost a Bible basher. He's the guy I know with the most Bibles in his house. There's probably 30 plus Bibles around his house, and he reads them. I'm not religious in any way, so I let it be. But so it does fascinate me. He obviously believes in some aspects, but he has a different weight, if you like, of how important some things are. And I think that's another lesson for us, actually. We all look around and some things are really important to us, and others to other people is not important at all.
I noticed, just when watching interviews, watching podcasts, watching, like London Real, Joe Rogan, sometimes there's things in life that happen that is so painful that people never really get over them, whether it was childhood stuff, traumatic stuff, whatever it is. Is your experience from around that time in your life with the event, is it one of those things that you'll just never get over, or do you feel like
No,
you have got over it?
I will. I will. That means I'm not quite there yet. Laughing at my own language here.
It's interesting, isn't it? Because that's 10 years ago,
it's more than 10 years.
and you haven't got over it yet. And I'm not saying you should or you shouldn't. I'm just saying it's interesting, the gravity of that experience, and the impact of that experience on you was significant by the sound of it.
There are some things that you can only see this in hindsight. That's the fascinating thing about challenges, is that we've all got devastating things that happen to us in our stories. And I say devastating in inverted commas because it might be to us, but it might not have been, might be run of the mill to other people. And that's just part of our story. Actually, I'll give you I'll go down a different tangent here, but one of a different ex actually, it's maybe a bit personal, but I'll tell you anyway. It's personal because it's my youngest son. My youngest son has taken ill. In October, he flew out to Thailand to work, and within a week, he ended up in a wheelchair, and he has an illness, and we don't know if I was going to say he was bitten by a bug. We don't know. We don't know what it was that's caused this, but it's called PAN. Oh God, I'm forgetting what it's called now. It'll come back to me. He's got this illness, which is so rare. If you Google it, there's only something like 350 people in the world that have got it at any one time. So there's no doctors in the world that actually have the proper experience and knowing how to deal with it. So he's still now a guinea pig, if you like, for various drugs. And I think he said he's on 38 drugs a day at the moment, pills a day, which of course half of them are trying to counteract the side effects of the others. It's craziness.
Oh,
I don't
God.
know.
When did
Don't
this
know.
happen?
It happened in October, and he ended up in a wheelchair, and then he ended up in hospital for, I think it was 3 weeks. He was in hospital before he actually let anybody know. And so I jumped on a plane immediately and went out to Phuket, and all of my family, including my mum, thought I was in the wrong for going,
Why?
because he had basically said, I don't, there's no point in anybody coming out because I'm getting all the treatment I need. I'm in the hospital and, they're doing everything and there's nothing you can do for me. And so my eldest son especially gave me a real battering, verbal abuse for disrespecting the other son, and B, was it disrespecting and not listening. You're not listening to what he's saying, you're being disrespectful. Oh, selfish, that was it. So he says, you're being selfish and disrespectful. And I was just like, do you know, I don't know why my family sees it this way. Everybody else seems to think, absolutely, I would go out there. You know, he's your son. You know, you know, I've got three clients who are doctors, and all three of them said, you know, don't mess about with this, Mike. He could die this week. So get out there now, you know. So I'm like, yeah, I'll do absolutely everything I could to see him at least one last time, if that's the way it is. But, you know, in the end, the situation is now he was flown back to Scotland on the 22nd of December. He wasn't well enough to fly up until that time, and immediately straight into the hospital. They're now saying he might be wheelchair bound for life. And he's in his 20s, and you're just like, do you know, the challenges that you and I have been through might have been the biggest challenge to us at the time. We thought, you know, this is the most important thing in the world and no one else understands, etc. And that's probably what he's going through right now. And it's on a totally different scale to any challenge I've ever been through. And I have to, for my own sanity, I have to just kind of go, do you know what? This is his journey, you know, and he's got to deal with it. He's an adult now. He's got to deal with it in what the way he feels is the best way to deal with it. And I think that is, you know, a lesson for us all there again, is that, you know, we think that we're going through something major, but actually to other people, that's not a big deal at all. You want to see what shit I'm going through, sort of thing, you know. So it's a fascinating world, but the whole point of that story was just to say we don't really get it, if you like, until we look back in hindsight and then go, well, if that hadn't happened, then I wouldn't be here doing this now. Makes sense.
Yeah. How did your son, like, even though your family around you were saying don't go, like when you went there, how was he with you?
Oh, he was fine when he saw me. Okay. But of course, his first reaction was, what the f*** are you doing here?
Was it the kind of thing where he didn't want to make a fuss? He didn't want to inconvenience you? He didn't want you to go through the expense of flying? Was it that?
Yeah, totally, totally. And I mean, I actually spoke to his mum on the phone just like the day that we found out, which was about 6 days later. I actually flew out there, but maybe sooner than that. But anyway, I haven't spoken to his mum for, I don't know, 5 years or so, when I happened to bump into her on the street one time. But we don't have a reason to speak, but we didn't fall out with each other or anything. So, you know, we can get on fine and chat. But she was just like, no, we just have to wait till he says that he wants someone to come and visit. That's what he wants, you know. And I'm just like, do you know, my point is, he's already proven that he's not going to call us because he doesn't want to worry anyone. Mm. He's in a wheelchair. Sorry, he's in a hospital for the last 3 weeks and nobody knew. And my doctors are telling me that this is serious. This is a very, very serious illness. You know, I'm not going to just wait until he says, okay, it's desperate now, or I get a call from the hospital saying he's gone, you know, I'm bloody going. And so I did, you know. But yeah, that was, I get it from his point as well, because, you know, in my camper van story, that's part of what I did as well. My own ego wouldn't let me call my family. And so I totally, totally understand where he's at. And I was like, to my mind, I've just got to be there. And at least, you know, if he's fine, absolutely great, I could go and enjoy the sights, you know. If he's not, at least I made an effort to do something about it, you know, and I won't hit myself for the rest of my life.
It sounds like he's got the same trait as you then, like kind of not wanting to inconvenience other people, you know, that guess, kind of thing, wanting to do it on his own, you know, not wanting to be a pain in the ass. I mean, that's what I'm hearing. Is that it?
Yeah, I think you're right, actually. Yep.
Yeah, yeah. Because, like, we need... I fall into the same trap, Mike. I think I've got the same traits. I think we're similar in many ways. You know, that there's been times... I mean, we need help from friends. Because, you know, friends are essential and family for, you know, for helping us, for giving us feedback, for, you know, steering us out of danger. And, like, if we're... if we're not, you can get caught up not asking for help, and it can be a sticky situation like that, can't it?
Oh yeah, totally. There was another time that I actually seriously was like, you know, 10 quid would make such a difference to me right now. And I would rather someone give me 100 quid just to see me through this period. And I just genuinely wouldn't ask anyone. So it's really, really quite sad, but that's, you know, not everybody's like that. That's the thing I was at personally.
But also the other trap, just while we're on the psychology, I by the way, I love talking about this psychology, emotional stuff. Like, I find it really fascinating, especially the topic of suffering, you know, because I don't know, there's just something really fascinating about that. When you've been through stuff, what am I trying to say? The whole thing, like, everybody's suffering is valid. Like, I think, like, minimizing your own suffering can be a trap as well. Like saying, you know, other people have got it worse, I don't have it that bad. And you can, it's, you know, that's a tricky one as well, isn't it? I think perhaps you and I are both prone to that as well, you know, like minimizing our own problems, and you know, and that can keep it stuck. You know, there's something about actually acknowledging, you know, actually that was really difficult, that was really painful, and I was justified in kind of suffering. That's quite liberating. Do you see what I'm getting at?
Yeah, I think I'm always a wee bit wary about that because, you know, you don't want to become a hypochondriac and you don't want to start falling. I think we've probably all been guilty of this as well, falling into victim mode.
Well, that's the other end of the. Well, that's the thing. There's two ends of the extreme, isn't there? There's the victims, but then there's the people. But then at the other end, which we're more prone to, which is like minimizing and not wanting to cause a fuss, not wanting to be a victim, not wanting to admit a problem. And it's like, I think somewhere in between is healthy. Do you see what I mean?
Yeah, I think, but that's to my mind is the most dangerous part is the actual playing victim, or by all means accept it and allow yourself to play victim for a period, but give yourself a specific period for that to happen, and then go, right, I'm only going to let this happen for a week maximum. I was about to say an hour, but no, give yourself some leeway by all means. And just go, do you know what, okay, played victim, it's not helping anybody, certainly not helping me, so it's time to move on again, you know.
Yeah, I'm sorry to hear about your son. How's he doing at the moment then?
Good question. I'm not very sure, to be honest, because he's now living with his mum, and I never go around there, so I'm just waiting to hear from him. It's quite a difficult one now because he doesn't communicate very well at all. WhatsApp was the only way we were getting anything from him. And because he's on various drugs and things, his attention span is quite small and he doesn't want to be you know, replying to messages and things like that. So it's such a difficult time to go, is he okay? Or, you know, some days he's up, some days he's down, that's natural. But I don't know, Ben, to be honest, it's just one of these things. It's, if there is a recovery period, then it's going to take time to sort itself out, you know?
I know this is kind of switching topics a little bit, but I'm wondering, what's your go-to in order to get yourself in a great state of mind? Like, is it music, or is there certain speakers that you listen to? Like, what do you do to get yourself into a good headspace?
I think there's a number of answers to that, and it's probably different for everybody, but it's kind of like the Zig Ziglar quote that you don't just wash your face once, you know? So listening to, it's Tony Robbins' birthday today, so by all means, go and listen to Tony Robbins stuff again, you know. But there's loads and loads of great and inspirational stuff out there, whether it's Jim Rohn or Zig Ziglar or whatever, Brian Tracy stuff, etc., that will lift you and basically give you guidance that you can't really argue with, because it kind of makes you ask questions of yourself that is logical. You kind of go, right, yeah, that makes sense. Okay, let's do it. And also reminding that you are more powerful than you sometimes give yourself credit for, you know. So that's the inspirational stuff. But I mean, in answer to your question, there's loads of stuff, whether it's just doing some exercise, or whether it's music that might get you going, or just a totally different environment, you know, getting out in the sun for a wee bit, or going for a cycle ride, whatever it is, it's a, probably a different answer for everybody. And there's no right or wrong as well. It's just like, that is the zone that you're in just now. Let's just do it.
Do you know what gets me excited? This might be an answer you might not expect, but I like watching powerful males. That gets me. I like watching Trump. I like watching Mike Tyson. I like watching videos of UFC fighters like Conor McGregor. When I watch like kind of hyper masculine or hyper empowered, like, like powerful, rich, famous, sort of masculine people, that kind of gets me revved up. You know, I don't know what it is about that. Maybe it just awakens that part of me, or I don't know. But that's what I do to get revved up.
Well, that's going back to the caveman hunter thing, isn't it? Just like, yeah, I'm the hunter. I'm the powerful one.
Yeah.
I get that. It's not something that, I mean, if I watch Rocky movie or something like that, I can go, yeah, let's go for it. You know, I did 18 years kickboxing. So, I get it, but I don't go out looking for fights. And so that, I think, is kind of zened, switching across to going peace, man. You know, I don't need to go looking for them, to go looking for a fight all the time. It's not about fight. It's actually, you look at Trump, a lot of his stuff is about fear. So he's trying to get fear into people. And to my mind, that's the exact opposite of what I want to achieve. I want to do it by love and by positive encouragement, rather than driving people down and going, you're so little, you're so weak, you know, look at me instead. And that I'm the opposite on that, actually. I get it. I get the fight thing, and it is great for a period, and it doesn't matter if you're male or female. I think we all need to be the Superman or Superwoman for a bit, and know that you've got that strength within you. But it's not for me. It's not the driver at all. It's not inspiration. Well, I guess it is inspirational in its time. You know.
Yeah.
It's certainly not something that is my go-to. Go back to.
So we got to the point in the story where you were a real low, you were in your camper van, you ran out of money, you were considering jumping off the cliff. And then, so what happened from that point forward up until present day?
I was just lucky again. I mean, as I said, I managed to switch into euros. So I got 250 quid's worth of euros, and had to pay my 9 euros to get the parking space. But that gave me breathing space to bring money in again. And my first priority actually at that stage was to get off the island, because I was in Sicily, which is an island, and I was hundreds of miles away from my nearest friend, and 250 euros actually isn't enough to get off the island. So I mean, my ferry trip to get there was 550 on with the camper van, you know. So so I was like, okay, that's not enough. I've got to do something else. But in answer to your question, I think I was just lucky. I just put my head down, and I've been doing that ever since. I just put my head down and see who I can help, see what services I can offer. I think when you're at your devastatingly low of the low, and confidence-wise and all the rest of it, I've certainly been at periods where I couldn't even work out how I was worth 5 quid to anybody. You know, what can I offer service to anybody that they might give me a fiver for? And I couldn't even think of an answer to that. So I've been at all sides of the spectrum there.
Yeah. So what's your current situation then, Mike? Like, what services have you got? What websites have you got? What do you spend most of your time on?
I've never stopped, to be honest. I get so buzzed and excited by all this new stuff that's coming out. So I buy software almost daily, and it's mostly to help other business owners get seen online. So whether it's Facebook tools or LinkedIn tools or SEO tools or whatever, there's just so much going on and it's so exciting. So I mostly help other business owners get noticed online. That's my main income. I've got decades of experience now. I think that's probably the main thing. I was speaking to a guy yesterday. An inquiry came in via LinkedIn. And he actually said to me, you know, what's different about you if we use you for our website SEO? And that was my answer. I was just like, well, decades of experience, I guess. I put 20,000 plus hours into staring at a screen. And I know what works. I've got the experience in knowing what works as well.
So, would you describe yourself as a consultant, an internet marketing consultant?
Yeah, I guess I am. I mean, the first doctor that I helped with, they came to me and said, we were thinking about a webinar. They had no consideration of how they might monetize it. They just thought it might be good to put a webinar together. So fortunately, they gave me a few days notice, and so I had access to everything on their, their website and their Facebook and everything. And so I built a couple of hidden pages on their website, and I suggested to them, because when we were talking on Skype, I could see them on the video, and I said, what's all that and behind you on the shelves? And they had 50 plus DVD sets sitting on the shelves, and they were selling them at 275 on their website. And I said, well, how about we put together a bonus webinar special price of, say, £200? Right? So they thought, oh, that's a good idea. So when we did the webinar, we had more than 500 registrants. And on our very, very first webinar, which was just an hour long, they made 10 grand in sales. So if you think about it, do the maths, that's 50 sales at £200 is 10 grand. So they made more than that on their very first. It didn't all come in the first night, but over the first week, they made more than 10 grand. And that was selling nothing on the webinar. It was basically just saying to people, here's a bonus page with a copy of our PowerPoint presentation we've done tonight, and something else, another PDF that we'd put together. And so it was a hidden page that I sent people over to. And on that hidden page, I had, oh, and by the way, the doctor's agreed to give you this set of DVDs for only £200 rather than 275.
So just money for old rope, basically, just.
Well, they were so pleased that they actually didn't just get rid of all the DVDs off the shelf. They had to order more in.
Incredible.
And we've done it ever since. We've been doing regular webinars ever since, and making decent income, shall I say. I wouldn't say how much, but we've been doing pretty well ever since.
What kind of client do you prefer to work with? Is it a certain type of industry or a certain size? Like, do you have criteria?
It's not that I have a criteria. I've just never been involved in the corporate world yet. I would love to get a big client, but most of my clients are small businesses who've probably got maybe four employees. I was going to say a dozen, but maybe not even that, to be honest. If they're clever about it, they're outsourcing to people like me. I'm not an employee. I'm an outsourcer. I'll sort things for them, but they don't need to put me on the payroll. So, for example, the guy that found me yesterday via LinkedIn, I was chatting to him yesterday, and he said, I'd like to put like £1,000 a month into SEO. And I said, absolutely, yeah, I can definitely help you on that. If that's your budget, then we'll speak every month and work out what your priority is, and we'll focus on that. And that's his budget. I'm absolutely delighted with that. But of course, he couldn't get me full time for that. So, that's the kind of level I'm happy at. If someone can afford to pay 350 quid a month or more, then I can definitely provide the services to help them.
Is SEO your primary focus, or are you equally focused on social
Know
and
what?
everything?
And it's really fascinating that, because I generated my first income online 2 years before Google started. And so I've always been interested in what makes the search engines work and what they're looking for. And to my mind, it's not difficult at all. It's just logic in my head. I've never been stung by any of the Google updates or anything like that, just because I've done it all above board, and I've done it properly. And it makes it, to my mind, it just makes sense. It's like, it's just a piece of software. You have to give it what it's looking for. A great example, the example I gave this guy yesterday was, if I right click on almost any website, I can go to almost any website and right click on the logo. And guess what it's called? If I go to save image as, guess what it's called?
Logo.jpg.
Exactly. So the point is, nobody's going to go to Google and search for the word logo if they're looking for your business.
Yeah.
Right? Now, I could call it a table and chairs, and Google doesn't know any different.
Yeah.
Google's just going to go, all right, table and chairs. There's a picture of a table and chairs, you know. So what I can do is I can be ultra clever with this, and I can call it my keywords. And I actually proved this to myself back in 2002, I think it was, when I built a little website, and one of the images I called it was something like Top Scottish Coach or something like that. Mm. And when I searched Google, I was above all the bus companies for my image. And I was just, that's hilarious. I hadn't even considered that Coach was competing with bus companies. And it was an image of something, I can't even remember what the image was, but it was nothing to do with buses, obviously. And that's when I proved to myself that actually this makes a lot of sense, that most SEO people and most website designers are missing this trick. They don't realize that we can dominate Google with via images and videos and so on as well.
Oh, yeah. I've done the same thing. I rename all the images on my websites with the relevant, you know, keywords and the name of my service and stuff like that.
What I used to do, and I often tell people this as well, is that I would do what I call spelling mistakes. Now, Google's got a lot more clever than this now. And so, you know, it's accepted that a lot of people can't spell properly, like you're and you're and there and there and so on, you know. So, and there's different ways of spelling, and Google's getting more and more clever with it, almost artificial intelligence. But that's what I used to do. I used to think, right, what would people type in if they couldn't spell? And that's what I would call my image. So it wasn't visible to the human eye on the web page, but it was visible to the code behind, you know, to Google.
Yeah.
So that's how I used to do it with my images. I used to rename them. Maybe if I wanted, like when I was going through France and Belgium and so on, I would rename them in different languages as well. So that's what I did, is my alt image information. I did it in different languages. So it's all part of the code that Google sees, but the human eye doesn't see it.
And when you say you first started making money online before, it was the mid-90s, wasn't it? What were you first promoting back then?
96, I generated my first income. Actually, that one was quite interesting, actually, because I didn't know why I'd received a check. It was £115. Or was it dollars? It was $115, I seem to remember, that came through the port. Yeah, because I had a problem trying to put it into the bank. I got a check, and I'm like, what am I going to do with this? Where did this come from? And that's what it was. And when I checked it out, I had signed up as an affiliate to something back in 96, and I had forwarded the email to 25 friends just saying, I didn't buy this, but it's something I thought you might be interested in. One of my friends, I recognised, there was two people who bought it, and the one that I got, I think it was £25 commission, was a friend that I recognised his name, but the other one was someone I've no idea who she was. I think it was a double-barreled Christian name, like Mary Sue or something. Sounded American to me, and I made like £90, $90 commission, or whatever it was that she bought. And I thought, this is amazing. I didn't sell her anything. I didn't supply anything. I didn't deal with refunds or credit cards or anything. And I got paid commission for something. I didn't even pass it on to her. Someone else must have passed on my message. So that was my beginning, actually. That was, yeah, before Google even started.
I tell you, one of my coolest passive incomes was an interview I did with somebody, and they had a product for sale, and it was to do with like legal consumer protection stuff. It's something in that vein in America. Did an interview with the guy, just affiliate link in the video, you know, in the description, that kind of thing. It made about $10,000 a year for about 3 or 4 years in a row. just from one interview, I put it on YouTube, you know, from an hour's work, pretty much.
Amazing.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it didn't make me rich, but it's just in terms of, it's just such a cool, it's just so simple, you know.
Yeah. Well, some of them are. I mean, sometimes I get, you know, I as you said, I love waking up to money in the PayPal and going, I have no idea where they found that. That was something I did like 10 years ago.
Yeah. Yeah.
I love it. I mean, it doesn't have to be a big amount of money. It's just enough to go, wow, that's pretty cool that someone found that and it's still alive somewhere.
Yeah. And then you mentioned public speaking. Is that something you do often?
I haven't done it for a long time. I actually went off the circuit for a while. But now, yeah, I still do if anybody asks me along. It's not something I don't need it for the glory of being the star in the front of the stage.
Mm.
But I love, probably like you, I love the buzz of seeing that aha moment when people get
Yeah.
it.
Yeah. And are you gen do they invite you to speak about internet marketing and stuff like that? Is
Yeah,
that is that?
actually, yeah. I stopped for a while because, again, my own self-talk was this: I'm being a total hypocrite. If I'm talking about internet marketing and yet I'm actually physically having to be there, then that's hypocritical. So I don't want to be part of that. But yes, I've done stacks and stacks of presentations, and I never do the same presentation twice. So it's always on a different subject each time because there's always so much going on, there's actually that's a lie. I'm just thinking there's one presentation I've done three times now, which is actually randomly pulling someone from the audience and asking them a series of questions, and putting them on the first page of Google live in front of the audience.
Right.
That's a really, really risky strategy because I don't own Google, so I can't guarantee that it's going to work.
So how
But
quick will something get listed?
well, that's within 5 minutes of actually pressing the go button. But a lot of questions in the first place, so that everybody in the audience understands the thought process, the strategy behind it,
Hmm.
because that's where majority of business owners go wrong, I think, is they think they've got something to sell, they think they know what the keywords are, but they haven't actually done any research to find out what are people searching for.
Right.
So, as I said to this guy yesterday, that we're all experienced searchers now, and we know that we're not just going to type in limousine hire Edinburgh, because you're going to get more than one result. And you're certainly not going to just type in the word golf, because you're going to get millions and millions of results that may not be relevant. So if I just type limousine hire, for example, I'm not going to get the result I'm looking for, and I know that before I even start. So as an experienced searcher, I'm going to put in five or six phrase, words in there into the phrase, to get what I'm looking for. And that's what we've got to kind of go now, as a business owner, and go, right, okay, instead of just putting in his particular case, for example, I was picking up his hashtags. So he's put hashtags on his Facebook posts, but they're really simple ones, like, I don't know, limo or inspiration or fun or whatever. I'm just like, it's not good enough. It's too generic. We need to be more clever than that. If you're going to use hashtags, think about it the same way as keywords, and don't go overboard at all. There's no need to go overboard. There's just a need to be clever about this so that we can dominate our phrases that we're looking for, and it's the phrases that the public are going to search for.
So when you work with people, you're primarily working as a consultant for their business, as opposed to, are you teaching courses and teaching people how to do their stuff? Do you do that as
I've
well,
done
or?
that. I've done all that. I don't do that anymore because, as I said, I decided that I don't want to teach people because I don't think they should be spending their time staring at a screen. So instead, I flip it around now and go, do you know what? Pay me to do it and I'll just do it for you.
Yeah, because you're happy to do it, essentially.
Yeah.
Yeah,
For
yeah.
me, I can do it with my eyes closed, and it saves them hours and hours and hours of trying to figure it out. It's a bit like me with that grandfather clock. How long would it take me to work out how to fix a grandfather clock?
Yeah.
No, I saw that. Just pay someone, get it fixed. He's done it. So that's, I could go to classes and I can watch YouTube or whatever and learn how to fix a grandfather clock, but I'd rather just pay someone else to fix it.
What's your long-term goals then, Mike? What do you want for your, let's say 10 years, 20 years?
Well, I'm working on, well, actually, the bigger picture, what I'd love to do, go back to actually when I did my Inspire Scotland event, what I wanted to do then was actually do something along. I actually had five projects for that first weekend, And the biggest one was one that I didn't pull off in the end, because I realise it's getting bigger and bigger and bigger. It's too big for this weekend, which is essentially a project to, at that time, it was all about stopping our planet from raping and pillaging the planet just for gas and oil resources. And I was like, we've got to have an alternative to gas and oil. You know, we're looking at wind and solar now for energy, but actually even that is just scratching the surface, you know. The vehicles that we're using are, you know, 100 years ago, we generated the first combustion engine, and we're still using combustion engines. It's crazy, really.
Yeah.
We should be much more clever than that by now. So, you know, everything vibrates, and we must be able to tap into that and create free energy. So that was the big thing back then. But my big thing now that I want to do is actually focus on the whole plastics, saving the planet from the plastics pollutions.
Okay.
And again, I've broken that down into three major areas, which includes those that are doing something to create an alternative to plastic. And it's not just paper either, because that would end up knocking down rainforests to create paper for trees and things, you know. But so that's one thing, is an alternative manufacturing style. And the other is how to recycle, if you like, the plastics and clean up the plastics that are already out there in the oceans and so on. So that's the two major parts. And then what I really want to do with that is actually get major corporate sponsors to put this, to put a huge pot together, like a, you know, £1 million, ideally 10 million quid, so that we could actually have a award system for all those small companies that are creating solutions, and give them a cash injection. So like, if I give $100,000 to a local business that had a solution for cleaning up plastics, what could they do with that, you know? And so that's what I'd love to do. I'd love to have an award system for those that are doing something to protect our planet. The but to all that, of course, is it doesn't financially bring me anything. So meanwhile, I've got to juggle to make sure that I can afford to live whilst I'm doing that side of things.
Yeah. Let me ask you. I don't know much about environmentalism, and I wouldn't say I'm not a skeptic, but I'm kind of impartial in the sense that I don't really know what the facts are. I don't really understand it, and so because of that, I'm kind of on the fence. And so, like, I'm not sure what I'm asking. Why can't we just bury it in the ground?
Well, okay, so that's interesting that you say that, because there's so much information out there now already, and yet so many people still don't know it. And I think that's the biggest challenge, is education, to be honest. Like when I was out in Thailand, you're getting plastic bags for freaking everything, and it's something that you literally are just going to put in your pocket immediately, so it's not even going to last 15 seconds. What am I going to do with that piece of plastic? You know, am I going to put it in the bin? Where does it go there? You know, is it getting recycled, or is it just going to landfill, or is it going into the ocean, etc.?
Well, that's what I'm trying to understand. What's wrong with it going to landfill? I mean, I'm genuinely asking. I'm not sort of being...
Well, they're reckoning that each piece of plastic takes approximately 450 years before it eventually doesn't even totally compost, you know. So what do we do with it? Meanwhile, I mean, if you think about how many billions of people there are on the planet today, and how much plastic, that single-use plastic they're using, is just incredible. And you can't, what you're talking about landfill, but even with all the stuff, that rubbish that we throw away every day, where's it going to go? You know, you're going to end up with a 20-story high mound of earth with plastics under it all that isn't decomposing. It's just like that's not going to work, is it? So there's got to be a more clever system.
Well, I don't know. I mean, I don't understand why it's a problem. I mean, in terms of, like, this is what I don't get. If we just bury it all in the ground, like, I don't understand what harm does that do? I genuinely don't understand what harm that does.
Well, we can't bury it all in the ground. That's for a start, because there's just too much. There's too much stuff that we're throwing away.
Is there, though?
All the evidence.
Is there? Is there really too much stuff that we can't bury yet? That doesn't. I mean, that doesn't sound. I mean, the planet's a huge place. I find that hard to believe.
Well, okay. Let me put it this way. Maybe we could, if we went to the Sahara Desert or whatever and just put it under some sand and so on. Maybe it is a possibility. And that's actually what I'm coming back to with my thing, is that I want to say, look, I don't know all the answers. And it would be crazy for me to say I've got the solution when there are so many geniuses out there that do have solutions. You know, there are students that are working on this for their studies and so on. So by all means, let's give them an award system so that we can incentivize them. If I put a 10 grand prize out to all the universities in the UK that said, come up with a solution for either an alternative to plastics or how to recycle what we've currently got, clean up the mess that we've currently got, then I think a whole lot of schools and universities and things would rise to that challenge. And so I'd love to put that together and say, you know, I don't know all the answers. It'd be crazy for me to say I know the answers when there's so many other people that have different ideas. And each idea is worthy of its own merit, just like your idea of burying it. Yeah, okay, we've tried that, and that is a partial solution. It is partially working, but is there something better?
Yeah, I mean, it's all fair enough. I do find it interesting. I always get a bit skeptical when I hear people, because a lot of people treat this topic as just, it's all just foregone conclusions. You know, when you hear the average person talk, it's like, we're killing the planet, you know, plastic's a problem, and we need it. And you know, and I just question the foregone conclusions and the premises that are taken as given, you know, like, you know, you know, we need to sort of put our compost in the bin because we're killing the planet. And I think to myself, are we? Is putting the food waste in the compost, is that making any difference? I mean, maybe it is, but I don't see how it is.
Every little thing makes a difference. I guess it comes back to the story of the little boy throwing the starfish in the water, doesn't it? When the old man says, "What are you doing? There's 1,000 starfish on this beach. You're never going to throw them all in the water," and he's, you know, you can't save them all. And so the little boy picks up another starfish and throws that in and says, "Well, I saved that one." So, you know, if you can make a difference, a small difference, Ben, it's got to be worth doing something about it.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, I'm not particularly disagreeing, but not necessarily. Some things make such a small difference, they're just not worth the effort. You know, there is that category. You know, we can't go around spending our time and energy and money, you know, making marginal differences, because there has to be a line where, you know, you make a decision where.
I would disagree with the word can't. It's not that we can't. You can choose to do something about it, and you can make a difference one at a time, and every tiny, tiny piece of paper or cardboard or whatever, you can. But it comes back to priorities. Life is about priorities.
Of course. We could, for example, reduce road deaths by everybody driving at 5 miles an hour, you know, but we draw a line where we feel like it's worth the risk, you know, don't we? So, yeah. You know, there's always a trade-off with everything, isn't there?
Yeah, exactly. I think that, you know, life is about compromises as well. And there are consequences if you do, and there are consequences if you don't. Simple as that. And you get to choose which priority you're going to go for.
Yeah, fair enough. Okay, so yeah, so that stuff is important to you long term. That's a project you're going to work on. Yeah, interesting stuff, Mike. What else haven't we said? Did you have any final thoughts or words of wisdom for our listeners?
It's probably just the frame of mind I'm in just now, but something I just shared on Facebook a little while ago was, it's, you know, if you're in a low place just now, or if you're grieving or whatever, I've got a friend who just lost a baby yesterday, and it's just like, you know, it's okay, you know, it's okay to accept that that's just part of the journey, and the love that you've shared, even though that baby was never born, you know, it's, the love will always be within you, and it's okay. You know, we have grief at different times in our lives, etc. And whether it's a personal challenge or whatever, just to go, that, you know, don't beat yourself up about it. It's a phase that you go through. You know, if you look at the I don't know, the plants in the woods just now. There's not a lot of green happening, but spring's about to happen. And then, you know, we're going to have summer, and then it's going to be autumn again, and then winter, and then it gets, you know, really challenging again. And that's life, you know, that is life as well. We all go through phases of being really, really buoyant, and we can show off about it. We're having a great time, and we all go through phases of lean times as well. And wherever you are on your journey just now, don't beat yourself up about it. Just accept it and go, do you know what? It's okay.
Yeah. There, I did just think of something else I wanted to ask you. Just thinking back to that event, what is the lessons you learned? I mean, from my perspective, from the story you've told me, it's almost like you bit off. It's like you were too ambitious, got carried away, bit off more than you could chew, took too big a risk. I mean, that's how it sounded to me. But what was your lessons that you got from that?
On my Inspire Scotland event, totally. I was in a big ego space. I could afford to do all these things, and it wasn't. I didn't. I don't think. Maybe I was. I was going to say I don't think I was ever showy offy about it, but maybe I was. But I was certainly confident, and I was confident enough to go, no, we're going to make this happen, you know, and it bloody did, you know. But I also went through the total opposite side of that, where you kind of go, humility, you know, it's just like, got to be humble now, you know, there's nothing to show off about anymore. And so I can get it from all sides there. And I think there's lessons on every lesson, every angle, to be honest. I've had a number of people saying, approach me and saying, I'm thinking of putting on events. And I've said, absolutely, I've put in stacks of events, and I still do. But there's a big lessons to be learned here, and doing it in a different form to make sure that at least financially you're going to be covered, because I've been through that shit and I wouldn't want anybody to go through it. You know, it's a horrible place to be. So don't do that to yourself, but let's see how we could turn it around and make a difference to the people around you. That's what you want to put the event on for. Make a difference to yourself financially. By all means, just take all my lessons, my painful ones and my successful ones, and let's see how we can make your event a bigger success.
Have you ever considered writing a book about your experiences and the lessons?
I've written a couple of books, but not on that. When I was doing my camper van tour, I wrote a journal every day as well, but I've never published that.
Okay.
I did publish a lot of photographs. I mean, there's like quarter of a million photos on Facebook. I know that's about 60,000 photos on Facebook.
Wow.
Yeah, I've certainly, a lot of photos of the journey and things, but mostly what we tend to share on social media tends to be the uplifting stuff. I don't share my challenges in public, and in fact, as we've discussed, I don't tend to share it with anybody actually, but that's just who I am. But I think that's another thing to learn actually, that especially the teenagers need to know that the stuff that's being shared out there on social media is not necessarily a true reflection of everything that's going on in their world. It may be a reflection of the good times of that day, but, you know, there's other stuff going on.
Do you think there is a place for sharing problems? Is there something about that that's actually quite powerful, like showing vulnerability and that kind of thing? How do you feel about that?
Some people do, and some people do exceptionally well out of it. It's certainly not something I've chosen to go down. I think it's a... Again, it's a balance, because you don't want to go into the victim mode, but showing vulnerability and empathy and compassion and being able to help others is certainly, I know a number of people that do that for others, and they do an amazing job, actually. So, yeah, it's not something I've gone in down that route myself, but I have total respect for those that do it, because they are saving lives, and I'll give them that.
What would you tell your younger self? I mean, like your teenage self or your 10-year-old self?
Oh, my God. Good question. Actually, one of the therapies, if you like, that when I before I did the Inspire Scotland event, I was the president, I was the founder and the chairman of the Yes Group Scotland, which is basically Tony Robbins' support group, started in London 25 years ago. I used to fly to London every month for one night. And everybody kept saying, Mike, you want to start something in Scotland? And I was like, I don't know. Everywhere I go in the world, I'm the only one from Scotland. So I don't know anybody else in Scotland is interested in personal development. But as it happens, I did start it. And we had 60 people attend our first meeting.
Cool.
And so we never looked back from there. It was fantastic. It continued every single month until I decided to leave Scotland in my camper van and nobody else wanted to take it on, which is a shame. So it was a victim of its own success. But what I was going to, in answer to your question, one of our guest speakers that we had, she did a therapy called The Journey.
Brandon Bays?
Yeah.
Yeah, I read a book.
Yeah, yeah. Brandon, yeah, I went to London to listen to Brandon one time as well. And anyway, so one of the women who came to speak was a journey therapist. And so I did a little bit of a journey experience with her that evening. And one of the things that kind of opened my eyes is when she said, imagine your dad. Now, in my family's case, my dad was the dominant one. But that's not the case for everybody. But in my case, it was. And imagine him as like a three-year-old. And what would he be saying as a three-year-old to you now and so on? And it was really quite... I mean, that's just part of it. But it was really quite a fascinating eye-opener just to go, do you know what? I'd never considered that before. How interesting. That, yeah, you're right. He wasn't always the leader who knew everything, and bloody-minded with it, whether you like his decisions or not. He wasn't always like that. And that really helped me, actually, just to kind of go, do you know what? It's we've all got a journey, and we fortunately were never given the crystal ball to see what challenges might be overcome or have to be overcome. But there's a fascinating thing there, Ben. Let me just change the subject slightly. If you and I were to book a flight today to go to, let's say, Switzerland next week, for the sake of argument, it doesn't matter where the destination is or the time that it's actually happening. What does matter is that we know that between now and actually getting to the airport, there's going to be a whole stack of things that need to be reorganized, challenges, right? Obstacles. Whether it's sorting out the mail or the post or the pets or your baggage or whatever, clients, etc. It's going to be loads and loads of challenges and obstacles to be overcome. But you also know, you have that inherent belief that you will be there. You will be at that airport on time, regardless of the challenges. And I think that's what the universe likes to throw challenges at us and say, prove it. Prove that you really, really want this. If you really, really want it, we're going to give you loads of challenges. And you can overcome them and you will get there. As the airport's a great example. There's very few of us who have actually missed a flight.
Yeah, right.
And I think that's a great example because there's so many times that we've maybe had another challenge and just given up on it and gone, no, that's the universe is telling me I shouldn't be going there. But actually, like I did with that Inspire Scotland thing, I was so determined to make it happen. I bloody did make it happen, and that to me was the most important thing, was making it happen. I knew there was going to be challenges. I didn't know the devastating side effects of inverted commas, losing my money, spending my money. But nevertheless, the event happened and it did affect hundreds of lives, So, Does that help?
Yes. Yes. Fascinating, Mike. Yeah. Your thoughts. I'm really getting to the end, but the questions keep coming to my mind. What are you looking forward to at the moment? Like, I mean, in the near future, like maybe the next, couple of months or this year or something.
A big thing I'm working on just now, personal project, again, taking all my tools and experience, is I'm working on a love travel website. It actually I started it a couple of years ago, but it's something that occurred to me just at Christmas time when I was observing one of my Facebook friends was posting, and she still does. She posts stacks of coupons and vouchers and competitions on her Facebook profile. And I'm just like, where is she finding these? And they're all bargains or free competitions and things. And I thought, you know, that's what we're looking for. People, everybody I know says they love travel. And everybody loves a bargain. So see if I can help all those businesses out there that are trying to attract visitors and tourists and all sorts, and show them how they can actually build a mailing list of people that are interested in what they've got. So I've basically used all my software and all my creativity, and I've put together a website with loads of really, really clever tools hidden in the background, which is running on effectively on autopilot. I will employ a couple of people to do parts of it, but yeah, it's really just helping everybody. It's like, you know, Zig Ziglar actually said that as well, is that the more people you help, then the more you're going to make from it ultimately. And that's what I want to do, is work out ways where I can help the businesses and the punters, so it's win-win-win. I make money from it as well, which is pretty cool. But the main reason that I want to make the money is to put that on the background, so I could then focus on, as I said, the helping the anti-plastic stuff. So I can free up my time to focus on that.
Nice stuff, Mike. So what's the best way for people to get in contact with you?
Without a doubt, the fastest way to communicate with me is Facebook, because I have that running in the background all the time. So my Facebook URL is facebook.com/dynamicmike. I'm all over Google as Dynamic Mike on all the social medias. So it's just one word, so it's quite easy to find.
Okay, I can see Dynamic Mike Fan as well. Is it better just to go to Dynamic Mike?
Yeah, the personal profile is the best one. That fan thing I started like a decade ago or whatever, and again, that was a kind of an ego thing. Do I need a fan page now? But I very rarely go to it, to be fair. So no, the personal one's the better one.
Okay.
So it's Dynamic Mike is the personal one. And it's open to the public, so people can follow me without even having to send me a friend request or whatever, because I don't think I've got anything to hide. So.
Well, Mike, it's been really interesting hearing your whole journey, all the ups and downs.
Thank you, Ben. I haven't asked you anything about your journey.
Oh, no, that's okay. I was here to interview you, so it's all right. Maybe, you know, we can do another call another time.
Happy to. As we're talking, I'm thinking, wait a minute, I'm talking too much here.
No, it's okay. You're the guest on the podcast. That's exactly what I wanted for you to talk. So it's okay. Yeah, perhaps you're welcome. We can do another episode.
We should all interview you.
Yeah, we can do that. Maybe one day. I'm happy to do that if you want to do it another time, for sure.
How the hell did I get you in the first place? I think that was Eric Edmeads that said, you want to speak to Ben, get him as one of your speakers.
Oh, really? Yeah. He's had a journey as well, hasn't he? I haven't really followed the latest, but he's been on a whole.
Actually, I think I was, he used to talk about me from this stage because I gave him his first speaking opportunity. At the time, I was the chairman of the Yes Group in Scotland. And he managed to persuade me that he was a great speaker. And so I let him come along to speak, but he didn't tell me at that time that it was his first gig.
Really?
And look at him now. He now teaches other people how to be, you know, professional speakers from the stage.
Yeah.
It's
funny, I pretty much checked out of the whole personal development circuit for about 10 years, and I only recently sort of kind of started reconnecting with people such as yourself and other people, and it's incredible the amount of time that's gone by. It's about 15 years since I first started going to Yes Group in Bristol and London, and when I first went to UPW. It's a long time ago, and it's interesting to see people's journeys. You know, some people are the same, some people are very different, some people, you know, some people have got rich in the meantime, somebody had gone broke in the meantime. It is amazing.
That fascinates me as well, actually, because most of the people I know, because I did follow Tony around the world, you know, and I didn't ever choose to be a trainer or anything, but I got, you know, a lot of friends who are trainers and so on, which is like the senior level within the Tony Robbins thing. And what fascinated me is how many of them went through financial challenges and relationship challenges And I thought, that's really, really interesting. And I think there's a number of potential answers to that. But one of them might be that you kind of draw a line in the sand and say, do you know what? I'm not accepting below this standard. And you know, if they can't, I'm not going to compromise myself anymore if that other person doesn't come up to this standard. That's not an excuse for the financial situation. I don't know why some of them have gone through financial challenges, but it does fascinate me how many of them are single, and they're amazing people. I could put myself on that level. You know, I've been single for such a long time, and yet you know you've got so much to give to the right person, you know.
Have you ever had conventional therapy? I don't want to put you on the spot, and but have you ever done it or considered it?
No, I haven't. No, is the easy answer to your question.
Yeah. Well, I found my therapy useful. You know, it's a different angle because I came from, you know, the same school of thought as yourself with the positive thinking and NLP and Tony Robbins and law of attraction and manifestation and create what you want and focus on what you want. You know, I came from that angle, and like conventional psychotherapy is a sort of different approach where you do talk about the stuff. You know, the negative stuff, just to put it simply. And I found it very helpful. It does approach things from a different angle. And I used to dismiss it because, you know, I'd hear Tony Robbins saying, you know, I can cure a phobia in one session, and traditional therapy, it takes 15 years and you're still not done. And, you know, I kind of just absorbed that kind of attitude and just
Well, I
used to
did
just.
way back then, you know, the year 2000 or thereabouts. I did do, I am a qualified hypnotherapist and NLP master and all that sort of stuff. I've done all that. And even now I can help people that, you know, if they want to stop smoking or go through whatever fears or phobias or whatever, I know I can help them. And what I usually say to people is that I'm not going to put you into a traditional therapist concept where you need to see me every week for or every month for 6 months or something like that. I'll spend as long as I need to with you, and we'll get it fixed, and we'll do it in one session. That's it. So yeah, I like the Tony Robbins thought process there, where it's just like, instead of telling people how to fix, you know, show them the tools, and allow them to ask themselves questions, you know, guide them through the questions where they come to their own conclusions. And ultimately, here's a thought, Ben. Have you ever heard a question that you've never answered, even if it's just in your own head?
Question that you've never answered? Oh, do you mean like an unresolved question that just keeps running?
You ever had someone ask you a question, and at least in your own head, you've not answered it?
Oh, I'm not sure
We
what you
answer
mean
every question.
exactly.
We answer every question we hear, don't we?
Oh, I see what you mean. Yeah, I guess we do.
Whether we realize it or not, even if it's just to ourselves, we answer every question that we've ever heard, right?
Oh, yeah,
So
I
one day
suppose.
I was playing, when I first discovered this, like the year 2000 or thereabouts, I decided that I was flying back from London to Edinburgh one time, and I thought, I'm going to play a game. So I thought, whoever's sitting next to me on the plane, I'm only going to answer by questions. And it actually, it was really, really hard. It's really hard to speak for like 50 minutes or an hour or whatever, and only ask questions, especially if they ask a question back, because obviously you've got to answer, haven't you?
Yeah.
But you can answer in such a way that, and this was my challenge to myself, that I could end up putting it into a question. So I would say, you know, if they ask me, where do you live, for example, I might have said, Edinburgh, and then I would go, have you ever been there? You know, so
All
I
right. Oh, I
would
see.
always
So
be,
you might answer, but then you'll follow up with another question.
So
Right.
exactly. So I would keep, sometimes I had to keep talking and talking and talking until I could think of an ending. But I'd usually end up with something like, does that make sense? Or can you see what I mean? Or whatever. And if you can get them to, especially if you can get them to agree with you all the way along, so they're answering the questions and they're agreeing, right? And I just did it to you there just now, going, right, then you're agreeing all the way through, aren't you? Yes. And at the end of the day, you won't argue with your own logic, your own conclusions, right? Because you came with me all the way, didn't you? Yeah. So you're going, yes, all the way through this. I'm taking you to ultimately where I want you to go. And then I can just answer a question, ask a question at the end that you are going to answer, aren't you? It's like you just did it, didn't you? It's like, and I'm telling you the strategy I'm using just now, and it gets a bit frustrating because you're like, for fuck's sake, will you stop playing this game with me, Mike? But I didn't tell this guy what I was doing, right? So, and we got off the plane, and he shook my hand so vigorously, and he's like, "You're the most amazing guy I've ever met." And I was laughing to myself, thinking, he knows nothing about me at all. He doesn't even know my name. It's so funny because he never got a chance to ask me anything because I was just asking him. Does that make sense? So because I was just asking him questions, he thought I was interested in him. And guess what? Guess what we know most about is ourselves. And if we think someone's interested in us, then we're going to start thinking, wow, they're amazing. You know, they're so interested in us.
Yes.
But you could do the same with therapy as well. You could actually guide people through to their own conclusions via a series of questions, right? And ultimately, you're giving them the tools to teach themselves, if you like, so when you're not there, how they can fix themselves. Make sense?
Yeah, it does. I do remain a little bit skeptical because I do feel like I've got benefit, without doing all the kind of NLP hypno kind of stuff. But I see what you're saying, I see the value in what you're describing.
I think ultimately, at the end of the day, there doesn't have to be a right and wrong, right? So if it works for you, let it flow. You know, I remember the first time I flew to India, and within minutes there was so many rules getting broken. I'm like, what the hell has gone on here? There's kids that are naked from the waist down. There's men peeing by the side of the street. There's scooters. Everybody, like three people on a scooter, and nobody's wearing a helmet, going the wrong way up a one-way street, and everybody's tooting, and nobody's paying attention. And there's a cow in the street, and there's a pig as well. And I was just like, what? The phrase that came to me was mind fuck. I'm having a mind fuck here. What is going on? And then it came to me within a few minutes, the word accept. Excuse me. And I was like, do you know what? It's all flowing. And even though all the horns are tooting, nobody's getting upset about it because they're all just as crazy as each other. So they're really just letting each other know that, hey, I'm here. So be careful. There's no road rage going on. And the word was accept. And for the next hours, I was in my taxi ride to the airport. I kept seeing more and more amazing sights that were just an incredible experience for the eyes, and the nose and all the rest of it. You know, all the senses were getting hit, and people kept breaking my rules. And that's what I found so interesting. It was like, these are my rules. Who decided that I'm right? I found that really, really interesting just to kind of keep using the word accept, flowing for them, and they're not getting upset about it, so why should I? So, and that comes back to you. If therapy works for you, I'm accepting in that. I don't care. It's great, you know, go for it. Personally, I don't want it. It's not for me. And that's fine. I'm just like, yeah, absolutely. Why should I be right and you be wrong, and vice versa?
That makes sense. Mike, thanks for your openness
Don't
and
know how
honesty.
that came out, Ben, because it's not something I share.
By the way, have you talked publicly much about all the details that we talked about
Oh,
today?
I don't think I've shared that story in public ever, actually.
Okay, well, I'm glad you did. I'm
I
glad you
think
did.
probably four, maybe six people on the planet have ever heard that story. So, yeah, I've never shared that in public.
Okay, well, I appreciate your openness. I'm going to put it online, and I'll send you the yeah, so maybe some more people are hearing it now. But of course, it's going to be valuable. I mean, some of it is a valuable.
It's history now. It's kind of like, get over it. You know, it's just like, I didn't hurt anybody in the process except myself. So if the story helps someone else, then Yeah, great, I guess.
All right. Well, it'll be on iTunes and Spotify and YouTube and Facebook within about 14 minutes. So, thanks, Mike. It's been great speaking to you. I'll catch you soon.
All right, good luck, Ben.
All
Let me
right.
know if I can help you, by the way, mate. I'm so really so sorry I didn't ask you questions about what's going on and what your plans are, what you're doing.
No,
But
it's okay. We'll do it another time.
that's recording anyway.
Yeah,
Yeah.
yeah, yeah. All right, Mike. Speak to you again soon.
All right, take
All
care,
right,
mate.
take care. Bye.
Cheers.